Ish. All right, welcome to another session as James and I discuss and dissect The Walking Dead. Today we'll be talking about episode 3. Before we jump into the episode, though, we have some questions from some viewers on past episodes, so we'll answer those real quick for you. So James, some questions came in. We got kind of like half of what we're talking about with the intros. So let's just kind of step back there and talk about those again for a second. So what are the differences in the intros that you noticed?
Okay, so as we discussed last week, just the show runners like to give you basically descriptions of each character during the opening credits. So previously, Glenn's was the watch that Herschel gave him. Daryl's is the crossbow. Carol's or Melissa McBride, you'll see the knuckle knife that she has. So obviously when the characters leave the show, they remove the names of those characters and the background pictures behind their names. So what Robert Kirkman and Scott Gimple and Greg Nicotero all did was they replaced Stephen Young and Michael Cutlett's names with they actually removed them as the main characters, and they promoted recurring actors to main character status. So if you look at the opening credits, you'll see Eugene, Josh McDermott, and then you'll see Tara, Alana, Morissette, and then you'll see Negan, Jeffrey Dean Morgan. You'll see Rosita, Christian, what was her last name? Christian Serratos. So you'll have those four characters now as main characters. So the pictures behind them kind of tell possibly future events. Like Eugene shows the factory in which Abraham and himself went to create bullets.
So a little foreshadowing there.
A little foreshadowing that he will be creating bullets. Christian Serrato showed a factory building with broken glass. So maybe there's going to be a scene where she's involved with some sort of, you know, maybe turmoil where glass is broken, or she's in a factory where it's broken glass. Mm-hmm. You didn't see Jeffrey Dean Morgan. They showed the bat, and they showed the iron, which was talked about in episode 3. It was very particularly set. The iron was set next to fire. Obviously, he used that iron and burned Dwight's face. And then they showed Tara, and behind her name was a crashed boat. So look forward to something about a boat when it comes to Tara's part of the story. So they like to give you hints in the opening credits. And as you know, we talked about that last week, but it got cut off. So that's just the explanation of the difference in the credits. Whenever they promote an actor to a main character, they will place a picture behind them of an event that happened during, you know, their adventure with Rick and the group.
Do you think the images are literal? Like there's gonna be like a literal crash boat for her, or do you think it's figuratively speaking, like when she finds out that her girlfriend is dead, you know?
It could be both.
Yeah.
I think it's going to be more of an event because a crash boat just... I mean, why not a crash car? It's just too specific to me. I think it's going to be more...
Yeah.
I think it's going to be more of an event. It also could be figuratively and literally speaking because her world is about to come crash down. She just lost Noah last season.
Yeah.
That was a close friend of hers. She woke up from the concussion... and she found out that Noah had died in the revolving door. She's going to lose her girlfriend. She doesn't know that yet. And she's going to lose one of her close friends in Glenn. If you remember, Glenn saved her from the prison.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, she's...
Yeah, without him, she wouldn't be part of the group, that's for sure.
And she was also close to Abraham as well. You know, when they had that little adventure, you know, her and Abraham became close. So,
yeah.
You know, and... They shared a common interest. This is a little Easter egg. They shared a common interest as they both liked Rosita's breast.
And
Abraham caught her looking down her shirt. So they had some funny dialogue together.
Well, with Abraham out of the picture, you never know. All right, so another question. With the introduction of Negan, what are some of the differences you see between the comic book Negan and the show Negan?
Like we discussed last week, yeah. 2 weeks ago, the comic book Negan is a brute. So he looks like an NFL linebacker. He's a little bit taller than Rick in the comic book, but he's wide body. He's big, wide shoulders. They showed him as being this just hulking figure next to Rick. And he's a little bit more physical than Rick. I mean, the confrontation that he had with Rick in the comic book, he actually physically assaults Rick when Rick decides to tell him he's going to kill him. He physically assaults Rick.
Yeah.
In the show, he's more of a mental villain. He's a psychological villain. He uses his mind a lot to break people, not just his physicality. So in the show, when Rick tells him he's going to kill him, he takes him on a mind fuck, you know, RV ride, and then he basically breaks him mentally. And he purposely wants to break people mentally. So he's not as physically imposing in the show. He's actually smaller than Rick, structure wise. His shoulders are more narrow. He looks like a crackhead version of the comic book Negan, but he's just as dangerous, if not more so, because you know he's more cerebral. So I think we discussed the governor. They made the governor more physically imposing than his comic book counterpart.
Oh, definitely.
And they made Negan's character more mentally imposing. So that's the differences there.
I think that, like you said, forces him to strengthen his mental attributes versus, you know, just intimidating people with his physicality.
Yes, and you could see that he's also more sinister. I think he's also much more sinister in the show. He's more jovial in the comic book. Like he's a lot more jolly. In the show, he's definitely has a sinister edge to him. It's evil.
And like we were saying, I think that's because, you know, he can't just rely on, well, I'll just beat him up then, you know.
Exactly.
Because with his size difference there, he might not be able to. Nope. But he does have Lucille, which gives him quite the advantage. Although he did show some physical prowess over Rick when he dragged him by his collar towards the RV.
That was kind of weird. I mean, yeah. I understood it, but Rick is, come on. I mean, he literally dragged him like he was a child.
It's like a WWE style. You're just going along with it to sell it.
You're going to a grocery store and your kid is acting up and you grab him by the arm and drag him down the aisle. I mean, Rick was acting up in the grocery store and Negan dragged him down the aisle and told him he couldn't have the kid. This is a little too strong there for being a crackhead version of Negan. So. Crackheads do have strength, though.
They got that crack strength. Don't underestimate that crack strength. So, talk about the episode, the premiere. What is the difference between the ending of the premiere and comic book 100?
Comic book 100 basically ended with Negan. Negan's only kill in the comic book. This is spoilers for whoever hasn't read the comic book. Negan's only kill in the comic was Glenn. And after he killed Glenn, it shot right to him, you know, Rick telling him he's going to kill him. And Negan basically told Rick, hey, if you still want me to break you, he said, I have a couple of guys that are running a train on your boy. And Rick, you know, he didn't say anything. And he said, you know, here it is. Here goes your chance. Drive an axe through my face, you know, stab me in the chest. You know, you could do it. As soon as my body hits the floor, you know, my people will turn your people inside out. So they kind of used a couple of those lines and mixed them in, remixed it in the show. But basically, it ended with that. And then Negan walked away and said, ta-ta. And Glenn's body, everybody's sitting around Glenn's body in the comic. And the show, as you saw, the difference was it was dragged out. So the whole event was dragged out. And he basically took Rick on that RV ride to break him, and then after he came back, he also made Rick attempt to chop Carl's arm off before he finally intervened. So it was just a dragged out version of the comic with a lot of extra added material, such as, you know, Abraham dying, the attempt to chop Carl's arm off, the RV ride. A lot of the dialogue was added.
I think
But it.
I'm not sure if we covered it in the past episode with Maggie missing her beat there to blame Rick
Yes,
to
yes.
break him down even further. I thought that was going to be key moment there too.
Yeah, me too. And I think we did talk about it, and we said that that moment should have actually gone to Sasha, because it lined up for Sasha to do it as well. So in the comic book, Maggie, at the very next issue was issue 101. It started off with the group around Glenn's body, and Maggie blamed Rick, called him a coward, punched him in the face a couple of times. Carl intervened, pulled a gun on Maggie. Sophia, who's dead in the show, actually then attacked Carl. It was a big mess. They all settled down, and they drove off to the hilltop together. In the show, as we all saw, Maggie, very weakened, tried to go to Hilltop by herself, and the survivors all, in the form of unity, told Maggie that they were going to go with them, that Abraham and Glenn were their family too, and nobody attacked Rick. So I think we talked about that too, how Rick wasn't portrayed as a coward to his group, which I think they missed out on. They should have done that.
Yeah, definitely showing the fracture of the group
Yes.
as well, not just like, mental fracture of Rick. So speaking of Maggie, what's the expectations of her? I guess her and Sasha now. Sasha's not in the comic books, but both of them are going towards Hilltop. Both
Okay.
of them have just lost their, husband slash boyfriend.
True. We talked about this before. I think that they're gonna make this. They're talking about pairing of survivors and antagonists. I think that you're gonna see a brand new pair. Maggie's going to be the leader, per se, and then Sasha will be her right hand. They really want to push Maggie to be a leader. They showed you this last season. When Rick said, "You need to start doing this stuff. You need to start speaking on behalf of the group because I'm a hothead," and then
Well, she did act as like the ambassador
she
for
was the ambassador.
Alexandria,
Correct. Yep. And even Deanna, she was prepping Maggie to be a leader as well. She was shadowing Deanna in Alexandria before she died, and Deanna actually, basically pass the torch on to her as the leader, as a leader. So, they want to press, they want to push Maggie into that leadership role. So I see her basically taking on her comic book counterpart and becoming a leader. I don't know if they're gonna have a developing conflict between her and Negan, but I think eventually she'll definitely be the leader of the Hilltop.
Well, she does have a bone to pick with him.
Little bit. Just a little bit.
All right, so that should catch us all up. Thank you for the questions. So let's jump into episode three.
So three, the cell.
So we'll start with some well, basic overview. How'd you feel about it?
I told you before, I like the bottle episodes because they kind of slow it down a little bit and they give you a little bit of background. They gave us some background on Dwight. They gave us background on the Sanctuary. They gave us background as on Daryl being a prisoner. But I just think back to back bottle episodes after that incredible premiere, I think it was a little bit overkill. I think that they could have split those two episodes up, and I understand why they did it, because episode four is going to be Negan collecting on his 1 week supply run, but I really think they could have thrown in another episode, maybe of the group traveling the Hilltop, or the Hilltop in some sort of peril, or just some sort of episode where it's a little bit more action, take us off of that slowing bottle episode type of thing. It was a good episode. I just think that going from such a high emotional high and then dropping with the care on Morgan, I think we recovered from the premiere enough that you could start rising the conflict a little bit. But to keep us down here a little bit more, I expect episode four should be, should pick up in the action. But then again, maybe not. Maybe it's just Negan collecting, So
Yeah, maybe it goes smoothly. Maybe they'll just give him everything he wants and they'll go on his way.
But other than that, I like the episode. I like the foreshadowing of things. I like, the annoying songs they played had, a lot of hidden messages in them. The first one with Who's the Boss? I remember having to watch that damn show in the 80s with my babysitter. They put that damn show on, and it was the most annoying show for a kid to watch. You want to watch cartoons, and they put on Who's the Boss.
So let's talk about hidden messages. Let's start with and Who's the Boss?
Who's the Boss? Perfect.
Who is the
Who's the Boss?
Kind of right there on the nose.
Right on the nose. Starts off, Who's the Boss? The Sanctuary, Who's the Boss? Negan.
Yep.
You know, and then they show like Tony Danza, and they just it was great. VHS, you know, you don't have cable anymore, so you have to watch old episodes of stuff on VHS.
You think he's watched the episode like 10, 20 times by now, and
10, 20,000 times. Yeah. I mean, you see him, you know, you see Dwight. It opens up with Dwight, and they show Dwight watching that episode of Who's the Boss. And Dwight obviously is, one of Negan's generals at this point, and he's trying to work his way higher in the ranks. But he has to submit to Negan, so that's Who's the Boss. And it just shows the different things he's done to basically show that he has some sort of power, going from beating the girl in the table hockey, stepping in line in front of the people for bread.
It's taking what he wants.
Taking pickles from a pregnant woman and her son, you notice.
Shitty.
Yeah. Taking
eggs
produce from, produce, yep, from the citizens of the sanctuary. So, you know, he's exerting his power a little bit there. But yet he's still submissive to Who's the Boss. Maybe that's Negan.
Do you think that ties in with a song, Easy Street? Do you think like he's just trying to tell Daryl, hey, just jump on board and take it down Easy Street. You can join me over here. Yeah. Get everything you want. Life's good.
Yep. I think that the Easy Street song just showed it basically is trying to break Daryl, but it's trying to tell him it's a hidden message in the song to Daryl. Yep. Say, hey, look. Easy Street, you know, you can have it easy, or you could keep hearing this goddamn song over and over again and not be able to sleep and eat a bunch of dog food sandwiches, you know. And I know, and it's just like, hey, it goes back to what we said last week. Negan treating people like dogs, literally. Daryl dog food sandwich. He sees these people as animals, as dogs, as canines. So Daryl stripped naked, he's filthy, he's eating dog food sandwiches, he's in a small, you know, room, a closet-sized room. He's being told when to come, when to sit down. I think at one point Dwight told him to sit. He told him to come. He told him to stay.
Yeah.
So it's you know, the Easy Street was, you can continue to live like a dog or an animal, or it'll be easier if you just submit to the boss, Negan. And it just all culminated to that point where he actually had the two interactions with Negan.
Yeah, and he did not submit.
No, he didn't. And that was a powerful moment in the show as well, because he's being tortured. Dwight shows him his options, being the zombies, being like Dwight, or being like the other prisoners, being like Dwight, or being like the zombies.
Yeah.
And Dwight explained why he did the things. He told Daryl at one point, hey, look, I messed up and I lost my friend because of my choices. I lost a friend. Your choices, you lost a friend. The scorecard is even.
Yeah.
He basically told Daryl, he said, hey, look, you know, Negan told the whole story about Sherry and wanting to marry Sherry's hot sister, and you know, Dwight was stealing the whole time instead of just, you know, Dwight made a bad choice. So, you know, I'm going a little bit off road, but Daryl made a bad choice when he punched Negan. Dwight made a bad choice. Instead of just letting things play out, Dwight could have let Negan marry the sister and give her the medication for her to survive. Instead, Dwight was stealing the supplies the whole time.
Yep.
Negan found out, punished them. You know, so it cost him the girl's life, it cost him his wife, and it cost him getting his face burnt with an iron. You know, so
Hey,
you know,
he's lucky to be alive, you know. I mean, if
and he said the same thing to Daryl. Hey, he chose you. He gave you a shot, man. You're lucky to be alive. And Daryl looked at, you know, looked at the White, and after the White showed him the picture of Glenn's head bashed in after he broke down, he said to the White, "Hey, look, I have nothing to live for, man. I have nobody to do this for.
Yeah,
there's no reason for it, you know." And you know, it showed Daryl basically, you know, not flinching when Negan had Lucille. It showed him saying, "My name is Daryl," when Negan wanted him to say, you know,
his name is Negan.
Yeah, so Daryl really has nothing to live for at this point. He's been tortured. He's been beaten. He's been fed dog food sandwiches.
So what do you think are the odds of Daryl actually breaking and giving in?
Higher than you think, but for reasons that aren't so obvious. I don't want to give anything away. It's not in the comic books because Daryl's not in the comics.
Right, yeah.
But I don't know if this will happen. This is just my... my guess, my prediction.
If Daryl,
yeah, if Daryl gives in, it's almost just to play along, just to get himself enough of an opening to get away. So if he gives in, it's almost like, okay, I'm giving in. I'll play dumb. I'll play your game, and when your guard is down, I'll escape. So. You know, Dwight is kind of, you know, in the comic book, Dwight kind of does this as well. So it's okay, I'll be submissive, but I'm doing it for a reason. I'm doing it to escape.
Right.
I don't know if that's going to happen. I don't know if they'll play that part for Daryl with Dwight being in the group. But it just makes sense that, you know, he may break. He's not going to break just to break and just to join Negan's, you know, saviors.
Yeah.
He'll do it. He'll do it and do it in efforts to escape.
I wonder if you think him and Dwight can ever reconcile and work as a team?
I saw a bit of that at the end. You know, the guy shot him in the shoulder. He stole his crossbow. He stole his motorcycle. He killed Denise. He's the reason why Glenn is, you know, he kidnapped Glenn, too. So Glenn obviously died because he got kidnapped. They killed Abraham. Dwight told him he wasn't aiming for Denise, he was aiming for him. So as many times as Dwight has screwed him over, the way Negan described the situation between him and Dwight made Daryl kind of, you know, have some sort of empathy toward him. It made him say, "Hey, look, I understand why you're like this, man."
And yeah.
Kind of had like that moment of, "Okay, I get it, and I probably would do the same thing, but I don't have anybody." So I think that there could be a relationship there, a coexistence. It won't be, you know, they won't be holding hands, you know.
Yeah.
But Chums. I think that they can, yeah. I think that they'll coexist for the greater good. Obviously, you look and you see Dwight. There's ulterior motive for Dwight.
Yeah, there's at one point. Where he's going back and he's capturing, his friend or whatever that ran away. And, you know, you see cuts to Dwight shooting him. And you're just like, he shot him in the head because, you know, Dwight's a good guy.
Yep.
Come to find out, he shoots him probably in the back or, you know, the chest. And then drags him back to the gate and puts his body there. And now he's a zombie. It's like, nope, he's still an asshole.
Yeah, he's still an asshole, but... There's a reason for that too. You know, if he shoots him in his head and shows him mercy, he can't. You know, he's not going to drag the dead body back. You know, he could, but you know, Negan's whole point was, if you don't join us, you're going to be part of this wall.
Yeah.
You know. So.
And they're talking about that in Talking Dead, where it's a challenge for Dwight to see like will he, you know, step up, you know, and how far will he go for Negan.
And that's true. So Dwight, okay, let's say he does shoot his friend in the head, shows him mercy and leaves him there.
Yeah.
Or he shoots his friend in the head and brings him back. Negan is so psychotic, he'll say to Dwight, "Hey, man, I know you killed him because he didn't want to come back.
Yeah.
You know the rules. There are rules." So Dwight says, "Okay, I'll show my friend mercy." So it's like, "I'll do you a favor. I'll help you and I'll help myself. So he shoots his friend in the back. He takes his friend out of the misery. And he also shows Negan, "Hey, look, this guy was trying to get away from me, and you know, makes up a lie. This guy's trying to get away from me, and I shot him, and now he's part of the wall. So he does his friend a favor, and he shows Negan, hey, look, I stopped him from running away. And we all know that he wasn't running away at that point. He had said to Dwight, hey, look, I'll go back with you. You know, I get it.
Yeah, it's like, you know, you're going to kill all my friends and family. It's like, you're fine. You know, I'll be tortured.
Yeah, exactly.
There's a common theme there with the walkers being used as a fence line. You saw it in the prison. You saw it in Fear the Walking Dead. You see it here with Negan. They're almost like an asset to him now. Yeah, it's pretty strange to see that recurring theme.
Yeah, and I think this is an extension of how they use the walker's blood, too. I think that they know that the walkers can be utilized to assist their particular armies or their communities, because obviously if you find out that you could put walker blood on you and walk amongst them, you're safe. Yeah. And obviously if you have enough of them and build a wall, it's just too much trouble for an opposing community to invade you. You know, it's just too much trouble. It gives you a clear advantage when they're fighting the zombies to pick them off from sniper posts or whatever. So
it's also funny to see how far they've come. You know, where like you saw like one, you know, zombie on the side of the fence line, you're freaking out. Now it's like, yeah, we got a couple hundred around there, not a big deal. You know, like the one in the barn, you know, back going back to the farm, it's like, yeah, a dozen in there. Oh, I want to break free. It's like now a couple hundred around the fence line.
What about the first one? The first episode where the one zombie, the former cop was behind the fence and Morgan wanted to run away and Rick was just like, hey, no, look, I'm gonna kill him. I gotta kill him. You know,
shoots him. I think he could have stabbed him, but you know, hey,
he was such a threat.
Though. Yeah,
he was behind the fence and he was a threat. So you know, you're looking at how far they've come, like Jay said, you know, that's a great point. You know, they've come a long way from one zombie being a threat to now they're utilized as an asset, as a weapon.
It's crazy. So,
yeah.
So let's talk about how Negan is running this sanctuary for his people.
It's similar to what's in the comics. So Negan has a system. He has rules.
Chain of command.
Chain of command structure, and he basically, I mean, you saw it in the premiere. He's almost, I mean, he's just an extension of the governor. So the governor with, I mean, when he met with Rick, and they sat down in that episode, Arrow on the doorstep. They sat down and they discussed, you know, negotiations, and the governor said to Rick, "If I let you guys walk away, that shows a weakness in power on my behalf." So he told Rick, you need to give me Michonne, you know, that'll show my people that I'm not weak.
Right.
Well, Negan has taken it a step further. He has to make examples out of people. And in the premiere, he said, hey, look, I warned you the first one is free. If I don't do something, this whole thing crumbles. The people look at me and I'm weak. I have to stay strong and stern because I have a following. I can't show them that I'm going to let you off the hook for killing 40 or 50 of my men. And then I tell you something and you blatantly disobey it. So Negan has to be this ruler and he has to rule with an iron fist or Lucille. And he has to basically, you know, be tough on his people. And then he has chains of commands. He has Simon. He has Dwight as his top generals. Mm-hmm. And then everybody else, all his soldiers, are Negan. So everybody is a single organism, and he runs it. You know, he has systems where you can get points. They grow their own food. Obviously, they get supplies from other communities.
Yeah.
It's a well-established community that he's built, and he has smaller rules. And if you notice, he says to Dwight in the beginning, you know, this was like trying to get Dwight to show some sort of emotion, but he told Dwight, hey, look, you can have any woman you want on me, you just have to make sure they say yes. So that goes back to what he does in the comic book. He believes in some sort of social, you know, structure. He still, you know, believes in not raping. He still believes in, you know, different things of that sort. So,
so pay attention to culture.
Yes, culture. Yeah. So he definitely told Dwight, hey, look, you pick any woman you want. Just make sure she says yes. That's That's crucial. Pay attention to that because he still has some morals to him.
And they had his wife there on the Talking Dead, and she was saying, hey, that's a test.
It's a test.
He wants to see. It's like, will he actually take his wife for the night? You know, Negan's just trying to figure out his loyalty here.
Mental, like, man. He's a mental guy.
Does Dwight still, you know, have feelings for his wife there, like, enough to, you know, possibly betray Negan? You know, he's just trying to fill it out, you know. What's his level of commitment to her? And then you see her later on with a pregnancy test, and he's
that's
just like,
another
don't
test.
Talk to him. Yeah.
Exactly. But that's another test. Negan's told him to go on with Daryl around that time.
Yeah.
Well, and it just so happens. Exactly. And, you know, that's gotta break him down even further.
Right? It's so, like, oh, there's my wife, pregnancy test.
I know.
She's sleeping with Negan, and they're driving a kid.
Exactly.
Great.
So it's just further mind games that he plays with these. Again, to make up for his physicality that he doesn't have.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
He's got to have that, you know, that mental strength that just propels him into being this scary, scary villain. So.
Yep. And he's poking and prodding, you know, and trying to find a weakness. And especially with, like, you know, something like his generals there, he wants to make sure that, you know, they're...
Yeah, you got to be mentally tough, man. Yeah. You can't... Come on. If the enemy captures you, I got to know. Just like last season when they captured the what the hell was his name? I can't remember his name.
Primo?
But Primo. When they capture Primo is, he's staring in the eyes of death. Rick is looking at him. He knows Rick is gonna kill him. He says, "Who are you?" And he goes, "I'm Negan, asshole." And he doesn't care because he's just programmed. He's programmed and he's just brainwashed and he just goes along. He's one of Negan's generals. He's one of Negan's, a part of that, you know, that community. He's one single organism. That's what they are. So, you know, we'll see a lot of that.
Yeah, they're like a single cell organism with like a little tendril sticking out. Well, lacking on my biochemistry, what the term would be for that. I remember seeing those in the old textbooks, but it is crazy. They're like, it's almost like an ant, you know, population where they have like the one single goal where ants will lay themselves down to make like a bridge for the other ants.
Yep. But it's obviously it works, and they're a very strong community. They're an army, and they're really going to be tough for Rick and Alexandria to compete with. And you'll see how they actually have to fight against Negan. It's not what you think, and I'll just say it right now. If it was Rick right now, they would not win. Alexandria has no chance against the Saviors. None. Even in the comics, none.
Yeah, and they lost two people are dead, and they lost Maggie and Sasha to Hilltop. Everybody's fragile, which I guess going back to our original about Maggie blaming Rick, I like to see that just to even fracture me even more. But like, you guys can't fight back right now. Look at you. You guys can't get along with each other. How can you guys come together for a fight against someone like this?
Yeah. This guy is dangerous, man.
Oh, yeah. So it'll be interesting. So let's talk about our predictions for his upcoming episode. So he's going to show up there. That was a preview for, I think, even before the season even aired, where it showed Negan knock on the gate with Lucille. So you knew he was going to go to Alexandria at some point.
Yep.
Do you think it's going to go well, or do you think they're going to try to fight him off?
Well, looking at the previews and Rick saying, you know, he's giving that speech, and it's just like this is similar to the comic books.
Yeah.
He says to everybody, he said, "Hey, I'm not in charge anymore. You know, Negan is. I mean, there's a reason for this. But it's also the truth. They cannot fight the Saviors community against their community. Cannot fight against the Saviors. It's impossible." Rick knows this. He has to get everybody to drink the Kool-Aid and understand this. He cannot revolt against them. It's impossible. They will all die. He said that in the premiere. It's just impossible. It's just they will all die, and the Saviors will still have enough to continue to invade other communities. That's how big they are. So Rick basically has said in the previews, this episode I think is going to be called Service. He's going to say in the previews, he's going to say, "Hey, look, I'm not in charge anymore. Negan is. I need all of you to understand this." And, you know, Negan there was a clip at the end of that preview, and Jay, you know what I'm talking about. I think we touched based on this in the first episode that we had. Negan gives Rick a look like he's right near his ear, and then he walks away from him. So we may actually get our wish and see what Negan says to Rick. And I really hope they replicate that comic book event, because that's one of my favorite moments in the comic, when Negan just says what he's... I said it in our first episode, but Negan just says to Rick, you know, if you watched it, you know, I'm not going to say it, then I'll spoil it. Yeah. And then he walks away. If they replicate that, if they reenact that in the show, that'll be awesome. I'm looking forward to that one, because I know that's what they want us to, you know, they gave that as like a little hint to the comic book readers, because there's no other reason for him to be that close.
Yeah, it's like right there in that same frame set. It's
same thing. Man,
this is like one of the seasons, even the premiere, I just have to get it on like DVD. I wonder if Netflix actually airs the AMC version or the, you know, the F-bomb version.
No, they don't show the F-bomb version. Yeah. You gotta get the Blu-ray.
Because I gotta know, you know, because I want to know how different it is.
I think that that's the one thing that is different about Negan in the show and the comic book that kind of takes away from his character, and I think that that's why they make him so much more sinister.
Yeah.
Is Negan drops the F-bomb, every other word he says is fuck this, fuckity, fucking. Yeah. He does not care. He drops the F-bomb in different variations
in between words, part of the word.
Most now, people what do you think
if they did
fucks?
Something like change like friggin'? It just wouldn't work.
I probably wouldn't even like Negan after that.
Or like the Battlestar Galactica, where they can't have like their own swear word, frack, instead of.
If they did some shit like that'd be just as bad as the goddamn cliffhanger for that.
Yeah,
come on. I think he's a little bit watered down, but I like this Negan because he's that much more sinister. He's dangerous. Yeah, yeah. I kind of like this remixed version of him. I mean, the F-bombs put it over the top, but you can't do that.
Yeah. And, what was I going to say? Oh, funny, that you're mentioning, the finale. Remind me of what Chandler Riggs posted today. Obviously, it's the day after the election, and Chandler Riggs said something hilarious on his Twitter feed. He said, geez, there's more people disappointed today than there were after the premiere. Or after the finale, actually.
Man, I had, you know, it is what it is. I mean, we won't get into politics. I think he's right about that. It's crazy. You know, the last 24 hours have been crazy.
Well, you can ask yourself, you know, like in modern day, like how does someone like Negan get in power by using fear to control people? Yes, you know, I'll protect you. Don't worry about the outsiders out there. You know, follow me. And, you know, we might have to kill some of them. We might have to force them into a simulation into us.
Yeah.
You might have to sacrifice a little bit here and there, but I'll protect you from the others. And it's
kind of similar. It's eerie.
You have one. They're both using fear to control the people. I mean,
and strange. And I'll take it a little bit further than that. One is using media, and what did we see at the start of that show? Was a TV episode. You know, a very popular sitcom. And now in real life, you got a person in power that basically had a reality show. So you kind of see the influence that people, you know, they manipulate, you know, you manipulate their resources.
Yeah, over exaggerate.
Exactly. So it's a tough day for a lot of people today. But like I said, you know, this fortunately this show isn't about politics, because I can't.
There might be some politics coming up. Hilltop over there.
Yeah, that's true.
You got the kingdom. You got, you know, the sanctuary now. You know, like
That's actually a good point, man. That's a good point. Maybe we can replace, we can watch that. That actually would look like better politics than what's going on right now. So
Right.
it would. It would. This is almost a joke.
But
So.
you watch this show and you wonder how people like the governor even, that might be a better example where he didn't use like force or smashing heads, but the people were afraid and he said, "Hey, I'll protect you." And he's just a little crazy.
A little crazy.
A little Protect you from the outsiders.
just a little bit. Just a
And
little
everybody,
bit.
you gotta come inside the walls, but you have to be just like us,
Now walls, get
Walls, yeah, right?
it?
Great walls, they're fantastic, they're huge.
Oh, God. Oh,
I don't
God.
know. Tangent, tangent.
Yeah, let's just go. Oh, my God. It's such a headache. You got such a headache from this crap. It's not funny.
Right, let's go back to something happy, Walking Dead.
Thank you.
Nothing like a zombie
That's pretty
apocalypse.
sad that the zombie apocalypse makes me smile. Just,
Right.
wow.
Well, for anybody else, but for you, you should probably show the stack of horror films sometime. Next time we'll do an episode, we'll put the stack like behind you of just
Oh
dozens
man,
and dozens of films from.
I mean that's not even my VHS tapes, man. I mean, I have a collection of about 144 zombie movies.
Jesus.
So that's just DVDs, Like I said, I have the old ones, the White Zombie. I have, I have one that's on VHS, Reanimator. A lot of people who watch this, podcast, if they watch Reanimator, I have the Evil Dead series. I just have tons and tons and tons of zombie movies. Like I said, I've been watching this since I was a little boy. And my parents were crazy for letting me do that, but I turned out halfway decent, I think.
Right.
just love this genre of horror and zombies. So when they had the show, I was a pig in shit. You tell people your whole life, everybody's making fun of zombie movies, and my classic line to people was, wait until they make a TV show, and people would laugh at me. Oh, you're crazy. Ah. And I said, it would be the number one TV show of all time if they make a TV show. And voila, what the hell happened? So, it's like a kid in a candy store. It's like a dream come true to see a zombie TV show. So, the zombie movies, we'll focus in on that the next time, and we'll go over them. And,
Yeah, maybe we'll do like a special recording of just picking through
just
some of your
this.
favorites.
Oh, God. I mean, I got some shitty ones. I got some great ones. I got some that I don't, they're there to make you laugh. And how bad they are. B flicks. It's great, man. It's great.
right. Jumping back on track over here. The Alexandrians, how do you think they're going to handle Rick telling them that they're now basically controlled by Negan? Do you think they're going to blame him? Like, why'd you put us in this position?
They're definitely gonna they're gonna question, what he's doing. In the trailer for season 7, Spencer had a line in that trailer that said we should have cut a deal with them when we had a chance.
You think that's going to go the comic book route?
I think it's gonna go the comic book route. People, I won't spoil that, but at the end of season 6, before Rick and the crew left in the RV, Spencer said, should we cut a deal with them? And Rick said, I got a deal for him, very confident, very arrogant about it. And the first thing, and not the first thing, but in the trailer, they made sure they show Spencer say to Rick or somebody, we should have cut a deal with them when we had a chance. And his eyes had bags underneath them. You could tell that they're stressed. You could tell that they're not happy with the possible outcome of Rick telling them Negan is now in charge. So I think that they're going to take to it and say, hey, you had us fight against 10,000 zombies. You had us, go step by step with your planning. You took over for Deanna. You've gotten a lot of us killed. A lot of them probably still blame Rick for a lot of the deaths in the community. And they still follow him. They still follow him through thick and thin. And for him to, relinquish this power to Negan and the Saviors is gonna pose a lot of questions. So I don't think it's gonna be pleasant at all. I think it's gonna be, what the hell is going on,
Do you think there's too much rehashed ground with Rick? Like, it's almost like a personal conflict. Like, how are we gonna defeat these guys? We can't defeat them. And then I'm the leader. We can defeat them. Let's get them. Like, is that like with the governor? They're too much for us. No, they're not. I'm gonna go crazy after them. With Terminites, they have. I guess that was more just like flip the switch. Like, now we're gonna kill. But with some of these groups where it looks like a bad matchup until it's almost like a Rocky effect where he gets his ass kicked until he comes around to overcoming them in the end.
I think in those Rocky movies, the difference between Rocky and Rick in those movies was Rocky had confidence and he knew he was going to get his head beat in the whole time. I think Rick at this point, he's met his match. And if he's going to defeat Negan, he has to take a step back and he has to plan for this.
You can't go headstrong in there
he can't,
anymore.
He can't go headstrong right now. I mean, even with Woodbury, even though they had 10, 15 people in the prison, He looked at Woodbury and, looking at, Woodbury itself and when they did the invasion, he saw people running. He didn't see any soldiers. They were able to go in and get Daryl. They were able to go in and get Maggie. Not Daryl. They were able to get Maggie and Glenn. Yeah. They were able to go back and get, it just showed you that they didn't see any soldiers. They didn't have any fear of combat from Woodbury. And then when you had the Terminites, the first thing he noticed was they pulled the wool over your eyes. So he saw a bunch of people who lured you into a trap. So you're looking at people who have to lure you into a trap to defeat you. That means if you get them, if you can get by that and face them, they're not soldiers. They're not a threat. The wolves, they're unorganized. They're just random attackers. He eliminated them like, he picked the booger and fluffed it somewhere. It was stupid. I mean, he literally killed like five of them in like 2 seconds.
AK and threw the side of the RV.
He didn't even look at him and killed him. I mean, one of them came into the RV and had a clear attack against him. He beats him up and shoots him and kills him. So it's like these threats are minimal, and now he's against a threat that's so massive that he really has to take time and think about his plan of attack if he does have one. But he's not going to even have the Rocky moment where he's going to go into this battle and expect to get his ass kicked and then in the last minute win. He knows not to go into the ring right now. He goes into the ring. If Rocky went into the ring, and let's say Rocky was Rick in this point, if Rocky went into the ring against an opponent like Negan, we wouldn't have any sequels. He'd be dead. it'd be Rocky won, it'd be over. Apollo Creed would have killed him.
Do you think Rick's processing, like, how can I kill him? Or do you think he's just still in shock? Like, I'm not sure which way I want to go right now. Do I want to go submissive? Do I want to, where do you think his mindset is right now?
I think that he's gathering all his information.
Yeah.
If you're a comic book fan, there was a moment in this week's episode that showed you there is a plan of attack on the way. It happened on a bridge. That's all I'm going to say. There is a plan of attack underway. But Rick has to really gather all his information. He has to assess the whole situation. He has to look at everything, look at all his resources, and he has to understand that it's an impossible task for him. And once he gets this understanding and gets his ducks in a row, he'll have a better standing against Negan and his Saviors. But like I said, right now he's still in shock. these crazy people and the whole army's coming to take half his shit, and there's nothing he could do about it. So right now he has to kind of like, he has to kind of like just say, "Fuck it, go ahead." I got to take one for the team because there's nothing he could do.
So you think he's gonna play nice then this episode?
Yeah, I think he'll play nice. Yeah. Just by what the preview showed.
Yeah,
it's too soon. The preview showed it. We all know that. Negan is obviously, he bangs on the fence. Little pig, let me in. And I think any other enemy that Rick is not scared of, they would have eliminated him. But obviously, if they show the saviors inside of Alexandria, the Alexandrians didn't put up a fight. They let him in. So, you know, these are fighting people. So they're not fighting against them. They're not fighting against the saviors. They know better.
Yeah. Especially after they hear the stories. You know, that's,
Can you imagine? I mean, just to put yourself in the character's shoes is what, that's what Kirkman and Nicotero and Gimple want you to do. So you're in this community, everything. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not even talking about Rick's group. I'm talking about the Alexandrians.
Tobin and Spencer. Yeah.
You're in this community and nothing happens. I mean, you built this wall. All the zombies are in a carom. They're in a valley or whatever. They're stuck between trucks.
Yeah.
There's nothing happening. All of a sudden, the wolves come. The zombies break out. You know, this guy, even before then, Rick comes into the community. He shoots your doctor. your doctor kills the leader's husband. You know, there's wife abuse that's now, you know, there's domestic violence that's brought to the air that nobody talks about, but Rick comes, and now everybody knows about it.
Yeah.
Now, all of a sudden, you go up against the wolves, you go up against zombies, you got to fight a million zombies, and now you hear about the saviors. You only hear about them. And then...
I think they're glad, like, oh, we don't have to get our hands dirty or anything. All right, we're staying out here.
Good luck, Rick and the group. Yeah. And now they kidnap Glenn, Michonne, Daryl's missing, Stasha's missing, Abraham's missing, Eugene is missing. Everybody is missing out of nowhere. All your strongest fighters are missing. Your leader now comes back. He comes back in a bloody RV. You don't have Daryl. You don't have Glenn. You don't have Abraham. We're assuming that Sasha and Maggie are in the hilltop.
Yeah.
Rick doesn't have any weapons. Carl is shaken. You know, you got Eugene who's probably crying still. You know,
I think Carl's probably the one who's handling it the best though.
Exactly. He's, so if you're like Alexander,
like Lincoln said, he's a future serial killer.
Exactly. You know, he's the only one that wasn't really emotional. He was pissed off. So now let's say you're Tobin, and you see this, you have this scene unfolding in front of your eyes. They're coming into the hilltop. You have to say to yourself, what the hell? Why do we let these people in our community?
Yeah.
Oh, what
and,
the hell?
Yeah, and they also have Morgan and Kara. I don't know if you mentioned them. They're up.
He's gone. They're gone.
Yeah. It's like, what the hell? Where's your group, man? Half of them are dead or gone.
And you think they want to fight the saviors? Seeing this shit? I would be like, give them everything. Right. I don't care.
Half of them died to the wolves, you know? And it's just like, they might. I wasn't sure they'd get a little cocky, like, yeah, we've killed off the zombies, but it's like, these are humans.
Some of them will. Some of them will crack too. You'll see some of them crack.
Oh, yeah.
Under the threat of the savior. So you're gonna see some of them crack and actually, you know, say, "Hey, man, what the hell are we doing?" You know. So that's gonna be important, and that goes back to you know, just paying attention to the previews, and and you'll be able to dissect it yourself. You'll be able to see what happens.
That'd be interesting to see, like, where. I guess the Alexandrians, how they treat Rick's group now, maybe like a lot of blame, like, well, you brought them here, you know, we've been fine, they wouldn't even noticed us,
nobody
but now notices. You went out there, you poked the bee's nest, and now here they all are over here.
Yeah,
thanks a lot, Rick's group.
Yeah, exactly. And it's coming.
Yeah. And even if they have that enough courage to even approach them, they're just like, I don't care, I'm gonna lock myself in my house.
Exactly. I mean, this is what we just talked about. I mean, what would you do if you're an Alexandrian at this point? You know, your strongest, you know, Rick is stronger than everybody in your whole community. He has this army of people. You got a guy coming in, who's Deanna? You know, you got people who are, you know, killing possums on porches and stuff like that. These people are wild. They're helping you, single-handedly killing 10, 20 zombies by themselves. They know how to kill people. And all of a sudden now those people are cut in half, and they come back battle just wounded and beaten. And you're not a fighter yourself. Now a big army of saviors is coming to take your stuff. At this point, you have to just say, give them the shit. I don't want to fight them. Are you crazy?
Yep, if I'm gonna help, that group can't take him out. I'm sure as hell can't.
Hey, you want this? Go ahead.
Yeah,
you know? Let me help you pack. You know, right. let me put this stuff into your truck. You know, have a nice day. You can't fight him. You know, and that's what Rick is dealing with. So, and you know, just to answer the previous question is, Rick is not going to. He's not going to have a Rocky moment right now. No. He's not even close.
No, and he does not have the backup of everybody either.
No,
there's no way Alexander's going to be like, yeah, let's go fight these guys. Nope, this group.
These guys are half missing, half dead,
or whatever, and the other ones are still like, "What just happened?"
As a straight 100% pansies, they're not going to fight.
No. But let's see what happens, though, huh? And this is going to be an hour and a half one, right?
Hour 15, is it? 90 minutes.
90 minutes.
So I think the total airtime is going to be like an hour. Usually the episodes are 45 minutes with 15 minutes of commercial. So okay. I think this is going to be an hour.
It's a little extra time on there. You get more story.
A little extra time, yes. And it's gearing up to the episode after service. I'm looking at it now. It's called Go-Getters. So that episode of Go-Getters, I think it will be going back to the Hilltop. So we're going to go to... It's following the comic book arc. It's following issues 100, 101, 2, 3, and 4. And a lot of things are going to transpire in these next few episodes. We're not quite yet to see what happened with Heath and Terror.
Yep.
But that's coming up too. But I think this is all shaping out to be an incredible second half. You know, end of first half, second half. Right now, we're almost a quarter way through the first half. So I think that they're starting to, you know, like I said, this is another bottle episode. It may be another bottle episode. It may be a conclusion episode or just a continuation of the season premiere. But expect it to start rising up. And it's going to get more intense. I wish they would break it up. But right now, I kind of see the pattern that they're kind of slowing it down for us just to take us on another ride. So
the name of the episode, is there any connection there?
Service, yes. In the comic books he says, this is spoiler for comic books, I don't know if this is going to happen in the show, but in the comics in issue 102 he comes to Alexandria and they clear out the zombies. And then he knocks on the gate and they let him in. And he goes, how's that for service? You know, we come in, you know, we clear out the zombies for you. You know, we wait, you know, we're not bad guys. You know, I don't want to bash in the skulls of Asian Americans, you know, to make my point. You know, and he basically is saying, hey, look, we're giving, you know, we expect a little bit better service. We're giving you a good right now. We're taking out all your shit work. We're killing the zombies for you. You know, we're being polite. You know, so service goes back to that. I think he's going to use that line probably in the show. I think he's going to say, we're providing a service for you, you know.
And do you think it ties into season 4 at all? Because with the past couple episodes, it seems like the titles have... correspond to significant events like the well, the cell.
Season 4, so service. I don't know. I can't see service. I can't see it tying into when they own. Well, that's season 5. Service. I don't know. I don't know. I don't think that they tied this one in. So I think my prediction about tying it in was wrong. So I don't see how they tied the service in.
Well, plus there's 16 episodes and there's not 16 seasons, so eventually they had to stop.
It was a good while it lasted. I guess that was a good guess.
Right.
He's wrong. But I don't see how they tied this one in. But it should be good. I'm kind of looking forward to what's coming. I think I'm more excited about what's coming. And as I said last week for the viewers of the show, if you ever think the show is getting stale, just try to look for different Easter eggs, like, you know, with the show. And it makes the show that much better because it kind of, like, makes you anticipate different things and it kind of plays with your mind. So it kind of freshens it up for you a little bit.
Definitely. You know, the producers, showrunners, Kirkman, they all have tied things in there. You know, their own little twists on things to keep us entertained, that's for sure. And James has dug through, rewatched episodes.
Yeah, man.
Definitely takes pieces out.
Yeah, I mean, there's one, if you notice the white, you know, doing his woodwork. You know, look at the episode if you're able to. A lot of people aren't able to rewatch him. Mm-hmm. But the figurines that he's carving, it shows Negan, or it shows one figurine standing in front of another one. And it kind of like, it's a replay of the Lucille-ing event. And then he carves other ones, and they're like soldiers. It's like toy soldiers. I think that also goes into some of the songs that we're playing. Mm-hmm. So they're like, they're trying to show you like, hey, these are all toy soldiers. They're at the disposal of Negan. And then you're going further into the episode, and, you know, the fat guy, you know, he purposely leaves the door open to test, you know, Daryl. He's a toy.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's like they purposely want you to see that.
And do you think Dwight's wife is involved in that? I mean, she just happens to be there when he sneaks out?
Or I think the wife
is innocent there.
I think that she's, I think she's doing that on her own. Yeah. I think she feels like she's responsible for what's happening to Daryl. I think that she knows that he tried to save her friend's life, her sister's life. I think that she does not want to be Negan's wife, but she saved her husband's life at the time. So I definitely don't see her as testing Daryl. I think that she's basically trying to tell him, just submit, just do yourself a favor, because she doesn't know the group. She doesn't know the Alexandrians. She doesn't know what Daryl has come from. She just sees him as another prisoner, another victim.
Yeah.
And she knows what happens. And she's just like, hey, look, just submit.
Yeah. As much as you think he's done, it can get worse.
It can get worse. Obviously, if we were able to take your bike and your crossbow, I don't think you're that tough. Like, she doesn't know how tough he is. She doesn't know he's like the god of people in the series. She just knows that he's a prisoner. And she feels sorry that she's put him in this position.
And that's weakness, you know. I mean, although he doesn't have necessarily a person or people to, you know, attach himself with, he has his own humanity, his own goodwill. That could be something he's still holding on to that he can still lose.
Yes.
And that's Sherry. It was played by Christine Evangelista.
Christine Evangelista. I mean, they're knocking it dead with some of these characters. I mean, you read the comics, if you read the graphic novels and the comics, and then you watch the show, they're almost replicas of, you know, they're the living replicas of these characters. It's incredible. I love it.
Oh, yeah. Definitely good job on casting. That's for sure. Good job casting.
You know. Hey, man. Looking forward to episode 4. And we have confirmed we will be filming on Mondays, Jay, huh?
Yeah. I don't see why not.
Man, I'm ready for it. And then, like we said, at the break, we'll do the Throwback Thursdays. I got some interest from some of my friends that watch. They're interested in that Throwback Thursday things. And
yeah, we'll go back, rewatch. You know, we'll probably do half season increments versus full episodes, just to kind of knock them all out. But they might be a little longer, just to kind of get all the information. And if we feel the need, maybe we'll do 3 episodes instead. Well, this was something we could figure out once we actually get in there.
Yep.
That'd be fun. But yeah, so if you're watching, check us out again Monday, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I'll be throwing out alerts on our Facebook. You know, follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Twitch, our website, YouTube, basically anywhere on the internet. So you can stay up to date when we'll be doing these shows. A lot of times it might be last minute or day before. Because, hey, you know, we're adults. Some of us have kids. Yes. You know, we both have jobs.
Some of us actually do dinner dates with the cast themselves. Like, some of us actually go to their houses, you know, and have coffee with the cast and the members, and play Yahtzee with them and whatnot. And, you know, that's... Not all of us get to do that, Jay, just to let you know.
I try not to brag. Not to brag. And obviously, he's joking. I love to grab dinner with everybody.
Yeah, he basically doesn't play Yahtzee. Everything else is almost accurate. I'm just going to throw that out there. Oh, man, it's terrible. All right, man. Well, Mondays, I'll be ready. Mondays, I'll be ready. And thank you to some of the watchers, some of the viewers that I know that gave me the questions and gave Jay the questions. I appreciate that. And keep them coming. Yeah. Try to answer them the best I can. And if I'm wrong or fact-checked or whatever, you know, let me know.
And tell your friends. Spread the word.
Spread the word.
Send us questions. Follow us, like I said. Oh, and before I forget, our quarterly charity is still going on. There'll be links right below. American Foundation for Suicide Prevention. You know, reach out. We can help them. We can save lives this way. I can't cure cancer, but I can reach out and possibly save a life by just telling them that we care about them.
Yep.
Especially in today's political turmoil, certain groups may feel forgotten. Certain minorities may feel like everyone else is against them. We just need to let them know that there are good people out there who will love and defend all their liberties. And fight for equality for everybody.
It's your story, man. It's your story.
But, hey, and on a high note, Walking Dead, episode 4, this Sunday, we'll be watching. Talking Dead following that. And like I said, have any questions, send it on over. Right, we'll be live Monday, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
Monday, people.
All right, thanks for tuning in, and we'll catch you guys next time.
Later, people.